Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Seven, Seven Wonders That Will Change Your Life by Glenn Beck and Keith Ablow, MD. Read by Pat Gray and Brian Sack, with introductions read by the authors.
A personal note. I originally intended to write something at the beginning of this book that would talk about all the triumphs and setbacks I experienced during my journey to become the person that I now am. But as I started to write, the words rang hollow. I began to wonder how honestly I could assess myself. Could I really give an impartial analysis of how I've changed over the years, or would I be tainted by the way I interpret my own past? Then I thought, why not ask my best friend and my on-air partner, Pat? Pat Gray is a guy I've known for a long, long time. In fact, he's known the real me for longer than I have. And I asked him to write the introduction instead. I knew that Pat could write from the perspective of somebody who has seen me at my highest, and he unfortunately also saw me at my lowest, who witnessed firsthand the changes that I've made in my life and the struggles that I still face. He's still by my side. He sees I'm still a work in progress. Asking Pat to write the introduction seemed like the best way for people to see the real me now, the real me that nobody in the press ever seems to be curious about, the guy who is struggling to do the right thing every day. Before diving into the book, I wanted you to see who I was and who I am today. Fortunately for me, my best friend, Pat, not only agreed to write and record this introduction, but he also agreed to record my passages of the audiobook. It's going to be very uncomfortable for Pat to read what I wrote about him. I thought I'd turn the tables. Otherwise, I would have had to read what he wrote about me and be uncomfortable. Have no fear. One step in front of another. Your journey begins now.
As you just heard, Glenn asked me, Pat Gray, to read his part. So when we get to the things he's written about me, I hope you feel as uncomfortable listening to me read about myself as I'll be reading about myself. The Glenn No One Knows, by me, Pat Gray. Almost no one other than Keith Ablow has ever bothered to talk to me when they're writing a story about my best friend, Glenn Beck. And that's pretty odd. After all, I've known Glenn for over 20 years through the good times and bad, both personally and professionally. Now, many people might think that the context I could provide would prove helpful to anyone writing about him. Reporters apparently think otherwise. Before this book, I'd been interviewed a grand total of one time about Glenn. It's a few years ago when I was still working in Houston. A reporter doing a story for a well-known newspaper called seemingly eager to know the real Glenn Beck. I spent about 45 minutes on the phone with him, but his story only used one sentence of mine. And of course, he tried to spin and twist the one quote he chose into something that would seem unfavorable toward Glenn. Turns out he wasn't interested in knowing the real Glenn Beck after all. He was just interested in creating his own version of Glenn. Have you noticed that the people who write stories or books about Glenn, and there have been quite a few of them, almost never interview anybody who currently works with him? It's always someone from his distant past with an axe to grind who gets quoted. Why? Is it that those of us who know him best have no credibility, but the guy who did the afternoon drive radio show in New Haven, Connecticut in 1993 is a 100% trustworthy source for all your Glenn Beck information? I don't think so. Is it that reporters can't figure out how to get a hold of me, or Stu, or any of the other people who work here? I don't think that's it either. Sadly, I think the reason that most of these reporters and people from Glenn's past have no real interest in writing about Glenn as a person is they care only about the controversy. So I thought this would be a good opportunity to show them what they're missing. Let's start with Glenn's company, Mercury Radio Arts. It now employs over 40 people and has lost maybe two or three employees in 8 years. There's almost zero turnover. When people come to work here, they stay here. If Glenn were the monster that so many have alleged, wouldn't there be a ton of turnover at his company? Who wants to work for a mean, hateful, racist, crazy employer? Why is it that no one is bothered to ask how the people at Mercury can help produce 3 to 5 books a year, a live 3-hour radio show, an hour of daily TV, a monthly magazine, several highly successful websites, numerous live stage tours and speaking events each year, and more? The answer is that Mercury is a well-oiled machine of people who truly care and love not only what they do, but the man they do it for. Despite the intensity of the subject matter, the pressure of deadlines and long hours, there's a fun and creative atmosphere at Mercury. The opportunities seem to be unlimited, and the possibilities seem endless. That tone is set directly by Glenn. During the healthcare debate, much was made about the very expensive healthcare plans that came to be known as Cadillac plans. We have those at Mercury, and they're free to employees. Glenn picks up the full tab. In fact, our healthcare plan is the best that money can buy in New York State. It's not a Cadillac plan, it's a Bentley plan. And you know how many employers in New York offer this plan free to their staff? One, Mercury Radio Arts. Mercury is a family, and because of that, we can do things that businesses with 200 or more employees could only dream of. There's no controversy, no drama, no infighting, and that is exactly why no one ever cares to ask about it. It's really unfortunate, because the real story about Glenn is so much more interesting than the lies. The real story revolves around a man who was very unhappy in his life, miserable in fact, but who became extremely happy and successful by changing his life. Yeah, I know it may seem like a contradiction because of how concerned Glenn is about the plight of the country, but believe me, while he may drive everyone around him insane, he's actually quite happy. Everyone can see the visible, tangible trappings of the success that Glenn has attained. Time, Forbes, the New York Times, many others have written extensively about that. Those trappings include, of course, a multi-million dollar company, he pays his staff extraordinarily well, in addition to the aforementioned health benefits, luxury cars, beautiful home, and amazing vacations. More important, he has a lovely wife, Tanya, with whom he has 2 beautiful young children, and 2 more amazing adult daughters. In other words, both in the material and emotional sense, Glenn has built a great life. What most people don't necessarily see, however, is the real story of Glenn's transformation. From someone who, for the most part, did not like people at all when I first met him, to a man who now genuinely loves and cares for them. From his friends and family to his employees, business partners, and even people he's never met, Glenn's devotion is second to none. Next time you meet Glenn out on the road, at an event, or a book signing, pay close attention to how he acts. Is he different when the cameras and microphones are off? Does he change when he knows that the national media isn't watching? Of course not. He stops and talks to everyone. He shakes hands and takes pictures with fans, police officers, event security, event organizers, stagehands, janitors, everyone. Again, none of it forced, stilted, or mandated by some corporate public relations person. It's completely genuine. He also gives. He gives of his time, his voice, and his money. In fact, he often gets into trouble with the person who manages his money because he gives so much. He has used his success to improve the lives of countless others. He doesn't share that with the world or use it as a public relations strategy. He just does it because it's what he believes in. I'm only sharing this much with you now because it's an important part of understanding his transformation, a huge part of why he's happy today. He serves others, and through that, he serves himself. He truly believes that the more you give, the more you receive. And he doesn't just preach it, he lives it. Glenn has gone from a man whose motto 20 years ago was, "I hate people," to the person, as I just described, that people love to work for. He truly engages and embraces his fellow man. We get thousands and thousands of cards, letters, notes, books, manifestos, and scraps of paper stapled to toilet tissue with a plan to save the country scrawled in crayon from fans wherever we go, and he goes through virtually all of it. I don't mean to create the impression that we're dealing with a perfect being here. Far from it. Glenn would be the first to tell you that, like all of us, he's a work in progress. He still struggles to be a good husband and father nearly every day. He struggles to find balance in his life, and he struggles with all the day-to-day pressures and distractions that most of us do. But it is so frustrating to see those who intensely dislike him try to label him as an actor, as someone who is insincere and says what he does for the money. Nothing could be further from the truth. No one is more sincere. No one loses more sleep. No one spends more time praying for and worrying about the state of the union and trying to figure out how to wake up people to the situation we face than Glenn does. Believe me, there are far easier ways to make money if that was all he cared about. One of the things you learn in talk radio is that you can't fake it and still be successful. Well, I guess you can for a little while, but eventually you'll be found out. With 3 full hours on the air each day, listeners and viewers can spot a phony from a mile away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.